I was born in Greenwich Village in Manhattan.
So you were born in Greenwich Village in what year?
1917.
And so you're 90 now?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And were you raised in Greenwich Village?
Well, it's a long story.
Okay.
Well, what happened, we were down in Greenwich Village. We were a block from the church we used to go to. And what happened, they decided to build the 8th Avenue subway, which wasn't in existence at that time. And the 8th Avenue subway, they had to knock down the apartment house we lived in. We lived on the 5th floor, no elevators, no electricity. They had the gas, you know, the flame, the gas lighting, which was dangerous, you know, in case somebody forgot to put it out, okay? So out of a clear blue sky, we had to move when I was, about 9 years old. We moved to the Bronx, where the rest of our family, my father was one of 12. And so we moved to the Bronx, and which was like going to the country from downtown. And that's where we stayed until the next episode. My mother had what they called a nervous breakdown, where she went crazy because she was working too damn hard. My father was one of those guys that would eat supper and take off. They still go play cards all the time. And so my mother had to take care of the four kids and do everything else.
So what happened after that then?
So she had this very nervous breakdown, and so they decided to, she was down at Bellevue Hospital in New York, which was for crazy people. She wasn't crazy. Anyway, so she was supposed to go back to her family. All her family was still in Italy. She's the only one of her family that came to New York. And so she had to go. At the time, she left in January of when I was going to be 10. January, which would have been 1927. And she took my two brothers. One was 8 and one was 6. She took them with her, and my father kept me and my older sister to live with him. So after that, we started living with my father's sister. He only had an only child. She only had a, so we moved in with her.
Was that difficult?
Yes, because she was an only child, and she was the boss of that family, and me and my sister were, although my father was paying half of the expenses for them, we were like outsiders as far as that family was concerned, which was a very bad experience. In fact, my sister was 4 years older than me, 1913, and she used to answer back. And so she wasn't too popular with those. But me, I used to keep my mouth shut because I didn't like to be. So it was very trying years. And shortly thereafter is when we moved in with my grandmother. Now, my grandmother was a doll. I got along with her. She still talked Italian. I had to talk dialect to her. She never learned how to speak English. But she's a very shrewd lady. She lost her husband when her youngest child was 2 years old. And she used to brag in later years that the fountain hadn't gone dry yet. In other words, she would have had a lot more children if she didn't lose her husband. So she was kind of comical, my grandmother.
So those were good years with her?
Yeah, and how, and especially the year that she turned 75, and her husband, one of her sons that lived with her, one that never got married, he used to run the house. We lived with her and him and another sister. Anyway, so this, for her 75th birthday, he gave her a bottle of wine, and she drank it all, and went visiting all her friends on the block. And when this uncle found out, he was yelling at her, like you embarrassed the family. But she was a character. My grandmother was a character. Incidentally, my two kid brothers went to Italy, like I told you about my mother. My mother passed away. I never saw my mother again after 10. She died. She had another relapse. One of her father or mother died over there, and she went crazy again. I don't know what she died of, because my father didn't talk much about it. But the war was starting. It hadn't started yet. But my one brother, who was born in 1920, he was going to be 17, so it should have been, 37. He would have been 37, right? 1937.
Right.
Was before the war. But what Mussolini was doing, whether you're American born or what, at 17 years old, you went into the army. And fortunately, anyway, to continue on. So he came, we recalled him. We didn't have a record of the passport or anything 17 years later, you know. And so we had to get, they sent us a picture of him, what he looked like, because we were going to have to identify him when he arrived in New York. And of course, he had changed completely, but we had the picture. And so he arrived, then we went on our own. We moved in an apartment, because now there was one of the sons was back. And then 2 years later, it was getting closer to the war, when the other guy hit 17, he came back. So now our family was back together. The day Pearl Harbor happened, I was at a dance. I used to go dancing every Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, we always went dancing. Me and both brothers. Okay, so what happened? In the middle of this, it was on Sunday night, they stopped the music and they says, "Today the Japs bombed Pearl Harbor." So it was a December 1941.
And how did you react to it? What did you think when you heard it?
I was in the draft, of course, all three of us, right? Well, I'll tell you one thing. It happened on December 7th, and we had a family party on January the 25th, because at that time, my brother was leaving. He was drafted the Monday after the 25th. The 25th, I think, was on a Saturday. And on the following Monday, he was called and ended up in Camp Croft, South Carolina. And 2 weeks later, I followed him. February 8th, I ended up being drafted, and I spent my 25th birthday in South Carolina. And he and I followed one another, you know, 2 weeks apart. He was always 2 weeks ahead of me.
Well, take us through then the training. Where did you go, or how did you end up in the Army Air Corps?
Well, okay. We were what became the 45th Division. We were training for the Army Infantry, right? The Army Infantry we were supposed to go in. So he left 2 weeks ahead of me. He went to his next station. I don't remember where he went. And me instead, they had told us this strange story about what you happened to you when you went in combat. They said that you would sit at a crossroad behind a 30 caliber machine gun, and they'd chain you to the machine so you wouldn't run off when the end. I said, hell with that stuff. Me and about four other guys, because the Air Force was looking for volunteers. They were losing too many, you know, over Germany at that time. So we went, and all five of us had to take a test, because none of us had college. You know, I came out during the Depression, 1934, and I didn't have any money to go to college. So I didn't have any. So all five of us took and I think two of the five, they accepted. The Air Force accepted and took us off the list to be sent to the next step before you go overseas. So that's how I got out. And after that, for a while, they took me out of the infantry. The infantry, whether they liked it or not, and they didn't like it. The sergeant didn't like it at all. He didn't like the idea that we went without asking his permission, because he would not have given me permission, you know. So we were sort of in the doghouse with him. But they left, so we don't care. But for the next few months, all we did was wait for a spot to open where we could go into the Air Force. So I was either on KP or guard duty, especially with a name like Bassi. They always start AB, you know.
Well, you eventually got into the program.
Right. So. Mind you, it happened, so they shipped us about the end of the summer, in September, they shipped us to Texas. In a train that didn't have any kind of priorities. If there's anything, they'd pull it over on the siding, and the trains then were not pretty like they are now. They were choo-choo trains, and all the windows were open, because this was going in the south, you know. This was about August, September, and boy, that room was, the filter was coming through those windows, oh gee. And then we hit Ellington Field, or San Antonio. We weren't at Ellington yet. San Antonio is where we ended up, and then we got assigned to, the next step to get our training.
Well, take us through the story of your training then.
Okay, I ended up going to Ellington Field, where they assigned us to different cities. I ended up going to Bonham, Texas. I was in 43E originally. It's according to the year. 43E, but there was too many for 43E, so they dropped me back to 43F. I don't know exactly. At that time, I knew what it was that meant. Sometime in 43, we'd graduate. So at 43F, I was, and I started my pilot training. Now, the thing that happened to me, they washed me out. But for the first week, every time they took me up, I'd heave my guts out all over the airplane. And they'd go down instantly, right? So I missed the first week of training. Then about 2 weeks later, I had some stomach problem from heaving. I don't know what caused it. So I spent 4 days in the hospital. Okay, so now I missed already 2 out of 3 weeks of training. So then they started. I went back to this instructor, and he tells me, he says when you're up there, and you gotta work the rudders or whatever the hell you call them. And he says, it's just like the clutch of a car. And I says, what the hell is a clutch? I had never driven a car in my life. I'd never had a car. So already he didn't like me. Right away he thought I was lying. And so the first thing you know, he sends me up for what they call an E-ride, elimination ride. He sent me up and I did everything he told me. But he says, well, He says, you can't fly. So I go to an instructor pilot, and he checked me out and go. I hadn't learned anything, you know. I had missed a lot of for training, and I go up with another. Incidentally, these guys were civilians. They were not army people. They were civilians. They're getting paid by the guy that they. So they weren't very patient. So I went up to this other guy, and his boss told him, this guy's okay. So they give me another instructor. The other instructor would take me up and not let me touch anything and send me up for another elimination ride. So then they gave me a third one, and they did the same exact thing. This time, they gave me Lieutenant Jones. I was finally in service. And I went up with him, and he seemed to like. He says, "Okay, we're going to land, and I want you to go up by yourself, have your solo." And I didn't know anything. I hadn't learned a damn thing because these other guys wouldn't let me touch the stick. And so I flew around once, and then I landed. Of course, I landed and bounced. And bounced a lot. Then I had never tried it before. And so consequently, Lieutenant Jones, very nice guy. He says, you did well. He says, we can't take a chance. And you know, so I guess you'll have to, you know, you're through. And so then I had to go before a board, you know, to decide what to do with me. And I was too stupid to speak up. Because then they would have given me another, I'm sure they would have given me another chance. But maybe I did right by not saying it because I'm still alive. And I want to be a fighter pilot anyway. Anyway, so then they told me they want to make me a bombardier. And I said, well, I'd rather be a navigator. And so they said, well, you couldn't pass. But I said, yes, I'll take navigator. And I did very well in navigation school. Mm-hmm. I went to the navigation school at New Braunfels, Texas, and that's where I, you know, became. And then after, I'll tell you another little thing that happened. But I shouldn't be telling you these things. There, we went out one day. Really, I used to get sick in there too, but O'Toole was the lieutenant. O'Toole was that was. We'd go up with three guys, all Bassi, all B's, three B's. We'd go up in this one, just three of us, with Lieutenant O'Toole, and I the first two or three times I went up, I heaved my guts out. I used to have the thing in my thing and keep writing all this stuff. And so Lieutenant O'Toole finally told me that he didn't wash me out. He says, because your log sheet was always spotless, nice and clean and accurate. He says, so I'm going to forget that you get sick every once in a while. I keep on writing. Anyway, so then after we started actually going on missions where we would do it and they would grade you according to if you called the right shots. And on one of those deals I had gone on, they wouldn't tell you anything. They would fly, and you would have to write down where we were and everything. And then they came out and said, what is your ETA? When are we going to get to where we're supposed to go? Because we had it all on our log. And so I says, I looked at mine and took a guess. And I says, well, we should be there about now, according to the thing. And so the guy flipped the plane over like this. He says, look down there. And it was right down there where we were supposed to be. It was fool's luck. I was just lucky. I had the right figure. When we graduated from that deal, now they assigned us a crew. And we ended up with the guys, I've been knowing from Adam, that you know, one Navigator, and the rest of the others were all a different school, the Bombardier and the pilot and co-pilot. All of them had gone to school. And so they assigned us to the, I don't know what the name is, some certain group, just like they do with this other one that, I can't remember the group. We were assigned to a certain group, and we stick together. And we did until we went overseas.
Who is the pilot?
Quakenbush. Quakenbush, Johnson. Johnson was the only guy in the crew older than me, and he was the co-pilot.
Was Quakenbush his first name?
Max Quakenbush.
Oh.
And not Quackenbush. Quake, Q-A-K, not the C. It's a German name.
So Max Quakenbush.
Max Quakenbush. He was from a little town in Kansas. And I was a guy from New York, so we didn't get
to know. How did everybody get on? Because you were all from different places.
That's right. Well, they tore us together somehow or another, and then we went to Dalhart, Texas, where we got our flight training. You know, you have to practice with the B-17. You go out on imitation missions and stuff like that.
Anything interesting happen, unusual, during that training when all of you were together? Anything stand out in your mind?
One does stand out in my mind. I don't know exactly the circle. All right. Just before we were supposed to get ready to go to the next, before going overseas, we went out on the gunnery range. In other words, they got things on the ground. You fly 50 feet off the ground, and you shoot. And the waist gunners practice shooting at things on the ground. So my pilot, Quakenbush, he wanted to go in the waist and fire some of those machine guns. So he told me to sit there with the co-pilot in the other seat, and I was driving that damn thing. And not only that, I was scared. We couldn't have been 100 feet off the ground because they were right over there. And we were going, and you'd go that way, and then you have to come turn around and go back there. And Porky Johnson was the co-pilot, the only guy older than me. And he let me fly it. So that was, if I did something wrong, we would not be here to talk right now.
Not a lot of room for error.
No.
So.
And then to follow, then the next step was they had to check to make sure that both of the pilots knew how to fly a B-17. So we went on a just to fly around, and we had a command pilot, they call him. I don't know who he was, a captain or something. And we were all second lieutenants. And so he gave Quakenbush a test, then he gave Porky Johnson a test, and finally they said, is there anybody else that would like to try? And I went up, and I flew on instruments. You know, all he did was look at that and keep that thing on the straight level. And he and I, me and this, whoever he was, I can't remember the name, we flew around. He was just checking to see, you know. And then he says, it's time to land. And he offered to let me land it, but I chickened out. I didn't want to land the B-17. That was crazy. So I said, no, thank you. And then that's when my pilot took over. But son of a gun, you know, when I think of that, if I'd had a chance in a damn school when I got sick, because this guy, he didn't know me from Adam, and he was going to let me land it. He's crazy.
Talk about the trip over to Europe.
Oh, that was easy. we landed in New York. And I took those guys over to my house for dinner. that's the matter. But we had to wait. We were in Brooklyn Navy Yard waiting for a way to get... We didn't fly over. We went on the Ile De France. There was two of them going. The Queen Mary, the old Queen Mary, and the Ile De France used to take... They used to go with nobody else. Now, the slower ones carrying supplies and everything would go in convoys protected by, the destroyers to, in case there was submarine. Hey, the Germans were destroying a lot of those things. They'd go so damn slow. It would take them, 10, 12, whatever. They'd go the slowest ship. The Ile de France went by itself, and it goes at top speed, 32 knots or something. They're moving, but they zigzag across the North Atlantic, because that's where the German, the U-boats were. So we went over, and all we did, we ate. Incidentally, that it was packed with nothing but troops. Down below, all the ground troops. We were lucky because we were the fly boys. We were privileged characters. We were in the upper decks, and I told them that I used to get air sick. You know, I says, and I was telling them about getting air sick. They says, if you get seasick, we'll eat your meal. You know, I never missed a drop. We only had two meals a day, but I never got sick. And all day we'd play cards. Just our crew. And so we got over very, very quickly, about 5 days, because we zigzag across and we go fast. And we end up in Scotland. Now we're overseas.
And so, and after that, did you end up then down at the base at Framlingham?
Well, first, when you first get overseas, they got to train the pilots, mostly for them, me and nothing. But for them, the pilots have to get used to flying over England and Scotland and stuff like that. So we had some training there. Then, as the bomb groups start losing people, see, we went over in a whole group. We were regular, whatever this name was, I can't think of it. Our group, we went over a bunch of airplanes all at the same time. Some were flying over, but I think they were losing people so fast that they decided to take a bunch on the boat, right? So that's when our group broke up. I had a buddy in one of the other group. He didn't go with us. He went to another bomb group and stuff like that. They split us up. Only four of us that had trained together in Dalhart went to the 390th. I don't know what happened to the rest of them.
Your crew arrives at Framlingham. What happened after that?
Well, then shortly thereafter, we went on our first mission, and we just had no particular airplane. We went up in an airplane that, was nobody was in. Okay, we went up and practiced in that. Then we went on our first mission. We went to France. They were going to bomb something in France, and it was overcast. And would you believe we would not bomb anything in France if you couldn't see it? So what do? We dropped our bombs in the English Channel and came back home. So that was our first mission, amounted to nothing. We got credit for a mission, but of course we weren't in any danger because we were close to the coast. You know, Paris is not very far. So then came the Berlin mission started, and we went on the first one that the bombs were going to. Originally, some of the fighter pilots had gone over Berlin, but we went on the first Berlin mission with the 17s. I think we were the first. And so we went up, and my pilot complained that one of the engines was not working. So he turned around and came home. And what happened? They checked the airplane over, and there was nothing wrong with any of the engines. And so we were not very popular. I had nothing to do with it. The pilot was not very popular. So because we had come back, aborted, they came. As soon as we hit the channel, he turned around and came back. He said, the engines weren't running. So we never got over. So then what they did, they said, we want you to fly this bomb gadget, the thing that drops the bombs. It was a famous deal that they were trying to keep secret from the Germans.
The Norden bomb?
Norden bomb, right. Okay. And so he and the co-pilot and me, I had navigated over England. We were going to this other place, and they don't want him to get lost. They want me to watch him or whatever. He did what he wanted. Anyway, we went over to his place and landed and got rid of this bomb site. And left it there, and then we flew back to Framlingham. And the first thing that we did wrong was, I guess I didn't navigate right, because we got caught in those barrage balloons they used to send up, that everyone saw an airplane would hit one of those things. And luckily we missed it, because there was this river or something that pointed right to our base. So we circled around. I said, there's the base, it should be over there. So now he comes into the base. I hate to tell you about this one. We come into the base, and I'm sitting in it was a brand new BG. Oh, the reason we went is that when the new, brand new airplanes came, they would send them out for just to warm up the engines. They do that with new cars nowadays, you know. You break in the engine, and so they'll fly better, or whatever. Anyway, that was his job, to fly the plane back and forth. And he hit the runway, and he came in real hot, fast. And he put the brakes on, and they didn't stop. And they went clear to the end of the runway, and the thing, just to show you, it came like this, and the B-17 came straight up like this. And I was in the bombardier's chair of a brand new G, and everything, I was sitting in the chair like this, and everything from here on was, I was practically on the ground. Everything was wiped out.
So it's like the plane did a hit.
The whole nose was completely, all that plexiglass was completely wiped out, and I'm maybe a foot or two from the ground. I didn't fall out of the chair. So then the next thing, the bad thing, came over like this, and that plane broke in two. And then they come looking for me, to wonder what had happened to me in the nose. They had the guys running around, and I said, it's like getting kicked in the behind, because, you know, when it backs you up on that seat, it sort of hurt me in the rear end. But I wasn't hurt. I was a little scared that I didn't fall out of the damn thing. But after that, that's when we got into trouble. Because imagine that. First he aborted the mission, then he ruined a brand new airplane. So next mission, 2 days later, we went to March 8th to Germany again, Berlin. And that's when we got shot down.
Tell us the story of the second mission.
Well, the second mission, we were going on. With all those bad things he did, we flew tail end Charlie. You know, there's like three, and then double threes they are. And so we were tail end. And of course, that makes you a sitting duck for the German fighter pilots, because you don't have the, if they come from in front of you, you know, you've got machine guns from all the you know, the nine in each group, because nine here, nine up here. And so these things went after us right there.
At this point, how much confidence do you have in your pilot?
Well, I you know, He says, well, I couldn't, the brakes didn't work or something. He always had an issue. He's a very nice guy. He's still a friend. He's still a friend. He's still alive. He was younger than me considerably, about 4 years. So what are you going to do? The thing that upset my let me tell you, the one thing that upset my pilot towards me is because I was a fatalist. I figured that I'd never live. I didn't expect to go home. So I just say, kiddingly, I say, some of those fighter pilots are going to have a bullet with my name on it, you know. Oh, did he yell at me? He says, don't talk like that. Don't talk like that. But anyway, so then the fighters came in, the FW-190s. They start high and they come towards you. So what happened? This time they hit us. You see, I sat right in the nose. The navigator, the bombardier sits right there, and I sit right behind him on the table out here with a machine gun right up here. And so I was sitting there, and all of a sudden, incidentally, you not only have you got oxygen mask. We were at 20 some thousand feet, so we wore oxygen. Everybody had oxygen. You're all on oxygen, okay? But you also had the flak jacket. You know when you go take an X-ray, they put that big heavy thing on you. I had one on and sitting at my desk, and my map was right there. And all of a sudden, the right through the plexiglass, this 20 millimeter flak come. 20 millimeters is a bullet like that, but it shatters.
Okay, was it flak or was it from a fighter?
This is from the fighter. Hmm. Yeah, that big flak, the big black, they were all around us coming in, right.
But it was fighter.
But the plane shakes a little bit, but that's all. I think none of the flak got to us. But this one got to us. And in fact, three of our planes went down when we went down.
And so these
were... this thing came down here.
And so these were shots from a fighter coming through the plexiglass.
Right. And that's when... this thing must protect me. I was fortunate because it splattered on my desk, and the fortune didn't get my hand, but some got by. One hit me right there, and one hit me right up here.
So in the thigh?
That part that's not covered, yeah.
In the thigh, yeah, and the arm.
Right there, I can still feel it hurts when I press it too hard. It's just a fragment, a small one. It didn't do anything. And then I got the one in the arm. And of course, then I got mad. I really got mad. I didn't like the idea. It didn't hurt that much, really, because it was just a... So then I got up and I got another damn machine gun, which was mine. And boy, I was firing at them, but I couldn't hit anything. But at least I was something up. Then the funny thing that happened, they hit the engine on my side, on this side here. And... the pilot and the co-pilot were above us. They were above us, like over here. And all of a sudden, I start seeing this red stuff coming down. And, you know, at a time like that, a panic time like that, you think it might be blood. But it was that red stuff that, I don't know, it's a part of the oil that's in the engines or something. But it was reddish. And, you know, normally you say it's not blood because blood wouldn't flow like that. But then I said, oh, gee, a pilot got hit. And right after that, that's when the motor gets hit, it runs away. You're supposed to feather the things like this, so they quit, you know, they stop. But these didn't, and they were speeding up and making a lot of noise. And every once in a while, one of those blades flies off. And if it flew off, it would have hit us, because it was just about right over our heads. So that was another thing that was a little bit frightening. But after that, that's when he started. He gave us a signal to bail out.
Can I ask you, do you remember what the date was?
March 8th, 1944, at about 11 o'clock of the day.
What happened after that? I mean, the plane's in trouble. What did you do?
Well, I didn't do anything. All I did was hear the bell go, and they say when it's out, you go, because the pilot is going to try to hold the plane until everybody bails out, and we're just taking a chance. So you do it for his, so that he could survive too. So immediately, or incidentally, I didn't have my regular bombardier. He wasn't there because the day before, on the 6th, all the bombardiers had missed their target in Germany, in Berlin. So they were all going to school. So I had a sergeant. See, the four guys were officers, the four, you know. And he was a sergeant. And he came in just to be there at the thing, and he hits the bomb when the front one goes off, and he drops everything there. So he bailed out. I never knew the guy before or after. He says, we go out through the hole, and it's a little bit of a hole. I don't know how the hell we went through. Or incidentally, the navigator and the bombardier, we didn't have parachutes on. We just had the harness, because the pilot and co-pilot used to sit on air parachutes, and some of the waist gunners had them too. They had them on their back. But we didn't. Ours sat in the corner. That's why sometimes, if your parachute got shot up, it wouldn't open for you, you know. So first of all, you got to get that and make sure you hook it on right. Sometimes they hook them up upside down, and they'd be going down up. Anyway, I was careful, and I hooked it on. It's just a little thing like this, across your chest. And then we went through the hole. And the other thing they advised us was, do not pull the ripcord as soon as you leave the plane. Because two things happen. Either the thing shoots out in a hurry, and it gets caught in part of the airplane, because they're still flying, you know, part of the airplane, and you get hung up. Then the second thing is, they got cuties on the Germans. If you open up too soon, it's target practice for the Germans. So I remembered that. And all I could remember was, don't pull your parachute. And so I was just dropping. You know, you drop down and have no sensation of falling? That's why skydiving, that my one and only skydive. You go down, really, you're heavier up here, so you go down just barely like this, like laying in bed. Really, it was so comfortable. I was looking up, and a lot of my guys didn't listen because I could see there was the white parachutes up there. You could see them. And meanwhile, I was going down, but now, you got nothing. You got to watch the ground that you know, wait too late. It happened. All these things, I'm telling you, these things happen. People would pull too late and end up in the ground. So I was going like this, but I couldn't see. We didn't have goggles or anything. And the air going past you, it was hard to see too. So I was like this. So I couldn't see good. So all I did was kick my feet, and I turned over. And the first thing I'm doing a swan dive. I'm going head first. But that was worse, because the air was coming up, and I couldn't see. So now I flipped back to my back, and then I was praying. And finally, it looked like I was getting pretty close. So that's the first time I said, I hope the parachute opens. And I yanked, and sure enough, it's opened. And a short while later, the other thing, you were supposed to not go in a tree, because guys get speared by a part of a tree and get stuck and get killed and stuff. So now that was another worry. So they say, sometimes you can work the thing. So I started yanking on one side, they say, to try to steer the thing. But the other thing that happens, if you pull too much, you're going to collapse the chute, and then you're going to drop like you don't have one. So now you're betwixt and between. Should I pull and miss the tree, or just take a chance with the tree? So I took the chance with the tree. And so I just rolled up and boom, and I stopped this far off the ground. And then I was hanging there. And then all of a sudden, this old man and this old lady, a farmer, he comes over, and the first thing he does to me, he goes, they were trying to see if you had a gun. And our orders were, do not carry the gun because they use it on you. So mine was sitting on the lot, so I didn't have one. But it was starting to cut me over here. That damn thing was starting to hurt. So I tried to you know, you just touch the button, you drop out, and the guy start going like this. You know, he was an old man, and he started looking like he was going to hit me. So then I made a sad face to the wife, figured she'd be more lenient, and she as much as nudged him to let me pull the thing. Then I pulled, then I dropped it. I was only a foot off the ground. And so there I was. And then that's when 10 or 12 people gathered, all civilians, women and children, and one guy that looked like a local politician or something. He was all dressed up, you know. He took over. He comes over, and he looks at me, and he puts a little, I don't know what it was. It wasn't a 45. It was a, and he had bullets in it, and it was around like that, and pointed under my nose, and they make me strip down to my long johns. Imagine me in front of the whole town there with my long johns on. I was a little bit embarrassed, to say the least. So then what I did wrong, this is the only thing they ever did to me. I was looking at to see if my other guys were showing up, you know, by now. And I looked at, and the guy gives me a swat over the face, and he says, look down. And so that's the only thing. I got a slap across the face. They didn't do anything to me.
So
and I just stayed there. This.
Where did you go from there then?
Well, shortly thereafter, this guy, the guy was in charge, two soldiers came. We ended up at the airport, at the local airport, and there was all the German soldiers, all these guys, spotless, you know, these fancy, all Luftwaffe guys. And the other thing that happened there, I don't know where they found all the guys, but little by little they stopped bringing all the guys from our airplane, including Max, who crash landed, you know, because there was a guy in they were shot up bad, and he couldn't bail out, and so he crash landed that plane. But anyway, to finish up, I was the only guy that had my lieutenant, second lieutenant bar. The others didn't have anything on, and these guys would come in the door, and they would point to me like I was because I was the only guy with the other two guys were both first lieutenants, second lieutenants, and they didn't bring that. I used to wear my stuff right on my shirt collar, and so they thought that I was the lead for a while. Until we didn't stay there very long because then they put us in a truck and they took us to a place to sleep. And mind you, we had had breakfast at around 3 a.m. And by 11 p.m., they brought us a little dish of soup.
I'd like to ask you a question, just so I'm absolutely clear on it, is that all you guys bailed out of the plane, the Phyllis Marie.
Well, eight of us bailed out.
And the pilot and an injured airman stayed on the plane.
He crash landed.
And who is?
And they walked off.
Which position was the guy who was injured?
All right, the thing that happened was our original crew member, the engineer they call him, the top turret gunner, he decided after the first mission that he didn't want to fly anymore. I don't know how they let him get away with it, but from what I've heard, if you didn't want to fly, you didn't have to fly. So he quit. So we had to get a substitute for him, which was this waist gunner that got shot. And one of our other old-timers took the job of the guy, the top turret guy. Okay, that's the only thing they gave us, a little plate of soup, which was very welcome. The next day is when they put us in a, I don't know whether it was a truck or anything. Anyway, we went right through Berlin on the way to Frankfurt, which is the first place that all the prisons used to be sent to was Frankfurt. We had a bad scare in Frankfurt. Anyway, they And we went on tour, and boy, was Berlin already in bad shape. We went right down the middle of the street there, and looked around, boy, it looked bad. But then they put us on the train, and we went to Frankfurt from there. And the thing that, this is almost comical, because later on. Anyway, we went to Frankfurt, and that's where we got interrogated. You're supposed to say name, rank, and serial number, period. And all of us, you go in a single room all by yourself, and then they come and get you. We lay down on the floor. There was nothing there. It was just floor. And then they come. We were there for a few days, okay? And they take one guy at a time. You go in there, and it was a pretty lady. She would ask you, first, she'd ask you your name, rank, and serial number. Then she'd say, what plane were you in and stuff like that. And we have to say, sorry, I can't say that. I can't tell you. And they offer you a cigarette. I wasn't a smoker anyway. And they say, you want anything to drink or something like that. But I said no to everything. But this one, the only thing I finally did answer, they said something about something about your parents, and I gave them the names. I gave them. I think that can't hurt in case they want to notify. She implied that they would notify our parents that we were shot down or something like that. So then I go where my father and mother came from, and that's all. I cut it short off there, but. Then, when they got through, oh yeah, wait a while, going there, this German soldier that took me there, he says, some people here have spoken too much already, keep quiet, don't tell anything. This was the German soldier told me to keep my mouth shut, which surprised me no end. And sure enough, some guys used to go and they'd never get out of there. But then we went back, and that's the only thing we had to do there. But that night was what really, although, I figured I'd never lived through it anyway, but I was never really frightened. I didn't have time to be frightened. But then, that one of those nights we were there in Frankfurt, RAF came over. They used to bomb at night. We used to bomb in the day.
The British, yes. Yeah.
And so it says, we got to hit the trenches because you can hear the ground shaking. We went into a concrete shelter. The roof, I'm not that tall. I was 5'10". The roof was white like this. And we were in like this, and a bunch of guys were smoking cigarettes. Then I said, boy, what a terrible way to die. I says, if we get hit, I'll never get out of here alive because I know these guys. I figured if I was near, I'd go out the door. But I figured some guys are going to panic and we were going to die here. And they missed us. But boy, the ground around us, we stayed there. And boy, haze of smoke right here. And then I was saying, if they hear us, boy, we're done. Because we would have been suffocated, I think. But that was the only scary part, really.
Where did you go from there then?
From there, now we had the bad part. But in the meantime, just to go back to that thing, about a week later, the bombs hit Frankfurt, and a bunch of guys that they had the prisoners. We were going in there. They kept telling us they were coming in so fast. We were losing so many people, and all of them were in Frankfurt, and they were getting so swamped. So they wouldn't keep you there. And if you weren't talking, they wouldn't keep you there. They'd get rid of you unless you were one of these guys that liked to talk. And so we were glad they got the hell out of there because some bunch got killed because they did hit Frankfurt, the RAF. Mm-hmm. So now what happened? all right, we go to the railroad station. And they load us up in those teeny tiny boxcars. The ones they call them, there's a name for them that they use even in the United States, a four-by or something. I can't remember what the name was. And half the thing was taken up by two soldiers with guns, and the other half was us. And we were sitting. You could not lay down or do anything. You just sat with your back against the wall, and a guy here, really, like, just sitting there. And I don't know if they gave us anything to eat or anything, I forgot. We may have gotten a part of a Red Cross box or something. And there we sat. And we couldn't do anything. And that thing was not priority. It would go and then stop, let the important cars go by, trains. What was that? Something came out of my mouth. Anyway, it was a very horrible experience because we stayed in that thing 4 full days. And one of the funny things was that I really don't know, we must have had a little bit of cheese and stuff to eat. I think there's something. It wasn't very much. We never left the thing. Except if you wanted to go to the John, they would stop in a railroad station with people and cars and everything, and these guys would get out and get into the tracks and do whatever they had to do. Me, I wouldn't have done that. I would have died first. I don't like to buy sitting on a pot or anything. So I never got out all that time. But after 2 days, I finally had a pee. And I'm a very funny guy. Me, when I'm peeing and a guy walks up behind me, it shuts off. I generally go in a closed one when it's a crowd, and I very rarely go into a public toilet. So what happened? I went up, I asked permission. The guard there, it was late at night, and we were traveling, and everybody was sleeping, laying all over. You sleep on one another because we were crowded. So I asked permission to relieve myself, and I got up at the door, and naturally the guy standing there waiting for me to try to jump or something, and I couldn't do anything. And I was hurting, so I sat down again because the guy looked at me kind of strange when I didn't do anything. So just to make a long story short, a couple hours later, I was really hurting. I got to pee. And so I got up, and wouldn't you know it, there was another guy that had the same problem as me. And so both of us got up. Now the guy with the gun was really watching us. And, you know, he and I talked together, and both of us relieved ourselves, all of that company. I needed the company. But it was very strange. You know, some of these guys were going on crapping in the middle of the plane among 1,000 people. For 4 days I didn't, but boy, did I suffer when I got to the prisoner of war camp. It's like going with a 2x4 coming out of your ear. Right?
Where did the train eventually end up then?
Then we end up in Bath. Bath, Germany was right on the Baltic. In fact, it was practically as close to Russia as the border was, because it's way up there on top. And that's where we ended up, and it was all officers except for the fact that there were the English soldiers that went down at Dunkirk in 39, yeah. Wasn't it? And they had the West, what they called the West compound, with some, I knew guys later on that were in the West compound that had been shot down early. The guys that got shot down at the beginning. But that compound was English and an American. But in our compound, nothing but officers. You figure out I don't know how many thousand we were in, but we were about 10 or 12 barracks 14 to a room with double decker. Me, I was here. My pilot was above me. My co-pilot sat there. And Tex Conaway, which I have to tell you about, he was in that one, in this far apart. And all we had is covering. Oh, incidentally, we had a straw mattress, Excelsior mattress. It's like straw. And four slats of wood, four wood slats, so there's no springs, just as some of the straw. And that we had one blanket. Me, incidentally, when I was shot down, they stripped everything that was authorized from the Army. I had warm jacket, you know, the fur-lined jacket, and I had, what else did I have? I didn't have the pants, I wore regular pants, but the fur-lined jacket and my Navigator watch they took. That was everything that belonged to, you know, that was personal watches kept them. But I had the Navigator watch, which was supposed to be precise, you know. So I had nothing to keep me warm. And I have to tell you one thing about Bart Journey, which is part of what happened to us. Bath, Germany is right on the Baltic. The Baltic in wintertime freezes. That's why you can't have any kind of water transportation up there. And December of 44, when the time of the Battle of the Bulge occurred, was the coldest year in Germany in the past 50 years. And that would have been December of 44.
What were the
techniques? And we were cold.
I was going to say, how do you stay warm?
Fortunately, they gave me all I had to arm was a OD shirt and OD pants, plus a sweater that my wife, she was a girlfriend then, a half sweater that I had underneath my shirt. That's all I had because they took the nice warm. So they gave me a GI overcoat, you know, down to about here. And that's the only thing that I survived. I fell later on the bed. You know, that was part of my blanket because the other blanket was a thin, thin blanket. It wouldn't have kept us so warm.
Which Stalag was this?
One. Number one. Well, like I said, all officers.
A lot
of guys say, you know, it was a country club. Really, except for the food, we never had to do a lick. The Germans, you know, start with sergeants over there. They don't have to work, you know. We didn't have to do any kind of work unless somebody would volunteer. And of course, I don't volunteer to do work. So we did nothing.
How did you pass the time then?
That was the problem. For a while, we were getting Red Cross parcels. One Red Cross parcel every week. We had a pack of cigarettes. And then you'd use cigarettes for money, because I didn't smoke. I use it for money. Okay, and then we had a Velveeta cheese. You had that chocolate bar that's supposed to be one cube is like a meal a day. It's very concentrated chocolate. And that didn't amount to very much, you know, but that was what we got. And the only thing the Germans supplied originally was the brot, German brot. That bread used to come in on flatback trucks, stacked like bricks. And I understand that somebody showed me a recipe. They used to put almost half was sawdust instead of flour. And so till this day, I will not eat brown bread. But that was... And I tell you about Tex Conaway. Tex Conaway was a character from Texas, a piece of a guy. He got the job of slicing the bread in 28 identical slices. With the end slices, we took turns eating the two end slices, but he used to chop 28 slices and we got two apiece daily. That was our food every day. two slices of bread. Now, we were lucky. Some of the rooms did not have a mess hall. Somebody, we happened to have a mess hall. But later on, I'll tell you a story about that one in a little while. We had a mess hall where we'd go there in the morning and have barley. Barley is just like oatmeal. But it had all these little things crawling around on the inside. All these little white things, you know. And, but the first time I saw it, I tried to move the white things. But after a while, you close your eyes, and then that was part of your food. But boy, the first time I saw things crawling around in my oatmeal, it wasn't oatmeal, it was barley. And that's all you got, morning. And then the evening, we got, we used to get stuff from the parcels, the Red Cross parcels that were getting in at that time. Later on, it got rough when they didn't come in anymore. And that had a little piece of cheese and stuff like that. But in the evening, they would give us a meal, but we never ate anything that was meat. You know, Spam? Spam was the Stalag steak, we used to call it, because that's the only meat we used to get. We used to get a lot of potatoes and not too many vegetables. But that was the second meal of the day. That was it. But that was enough to keep you alive. And the Red Cross parcels helped a little bit, too. They're like they used to have that little that jar that's about that big that with grape jelly. I don't eat grape jelly anymore either, because that's the only jelly we ever ate was grape jelly.
Were you able in some way to keep track of what was going on in the outside world with the war?
Okay, let me tell you about that one. They somehow or another, they used to bargain with the German soldiers, and of course they had to keep it. They wouldn't let everybody bargain because it would run price up, I guess, if everybody. It was maintained by what we called the wheels, where all the colonels. We never had a general. We had a lot of colonels. And at one time, we had a very famous, the one that ended up with us was Colonel Zemke. You must have read something about, because he was one of the aces from that great where all the famous pilots came from. I can't remember the name of that one, but you'll find that everybody knows that one. Zemke was our final colonel, but each time one that had, was an earlier date of the, he would take over. The guy that had been a colonel the longest, he would become top guard over whoever was there. And those guys used to have the first selection of the parcels. And the story that went around was that we had gotten some Argentine jam. And they says, we don't have enough to pass around to you people. The ones in there said, so we're going to wait until we get more, because it depends on what they got. But they used to get chicken, which we never saw. You know, the parcels were all different. They would keep the choice ones, those guys. I never liked that. But as long as we got something to eat. But then it was the Argentine jam. Then finally, we waited a few months, and they decided to distribute the Argentine jam. And instead of getting the whole carton, I guess it was like this, we got a little thin sliver. A thin sliver, in other words, they had eaten all the good ones. And a few days later, our place we used to go for breakfast burned down during the night. And they always said that somebody, I don't think it was a good idea, because at least we had a place for breakfast, but they said that somebody must have set fire to it, because they got mad about the fact that that one barracks with all the wheels had eaten all the Argentine jam, the goodies. So we, after that, it was worse, because we had to cook ourselves, and we had a stove this big, And it was cold up there, you know. It was this big, and they'd give you four little bricks to put in there. Four. And it was all black, out of oil bricks, I guess, not coal.
You were talking about trading with the Germans. Was there a radio? Was there?
I get carried away. Anyway, that thing used to come around, and we had, for me, I don't know how many barracks we had. We had about 10 barracks, 14 to a room. Later on, we had got two more guys when they were getting too many men. Anyway, this one guy used to get a typewritten sheet, and he used to have to bring it around to every room and read it and keep us posted on what was happening. But this same guy always did it. In fact, he was a guy, Simonich his name was, he went down the same day I did. He was in our group. He happened to be in our cat, and he was the guy that just have to. But he was, his orders were that if anybody, they used to come and search the rooms all the time. The Germans would pile up, and we'd get the hell out, and they'd search to see if he got anything, goodies. This guy would have to chew that thing. He couldn't throw it any place. He'd have to chew it because they didn't want him to get caught with any news that we was, that, so they wouldn't know what the news was, you see. But that was his job. He had to eat the paper. There were some comical deals. But in our room, text, I have to tell you the story with Tex Conner, because this is something that was well known at the time in our barracks. This guy was a character. All right. You may not like what I'm going to say now, but it's life, okay? This guy, for some reason, he used to swallow air all day long. He became famous. Tex Conway. I don't know if any guys at our barracks would know about him. Anyway, Tex Conway at night, as entertainment, the lights, oh yeah. Incidentally, all we had in our room was a sliver above, it was, they would have wooden doors on our windows, so it would be complete dark except for one space like that where air would come through. That was the only open space. We were really shut in, all over. All right, so then after he went to bed, he would start making farts. And he used to try to see how many he could go, and he was a record breaker. I mean, he was like 80. I don't know how he used to stop himself. Eventually, he became the talk of the barracks every night at the same time. Would come out. To try to see how far he was going to go. And then he also used to practice all one and to see how long he would keep going. Hey, we had to have something for entertainment. That was at the, but really, I just had to tell you about Tex Conner. He passed away. So he visited me in Topeka after he was still in. He stayed in for a long time. The question you had said, we did have available a lot of stuff from the Red Cross. We had like a baseball and a football. In other words, things you could play with, and also books. That's where I did a lot of book reading. I read like The Robe, all the famous books of those days. The Robe, you know about, that one guy, he used to write a lot about that guy, and I read all his books, and I read like that one about the a tree grows in Brooklyn. This goes back in the 40s, you know. And we could get it. We had a sort of a library for those books. But of course, you know, there weren't that many. But I read a lot of them that because we had really had nothing to do.
Did they offer classes or anything? Guys ever share their knowledge or anything like that?
No, we did have a band. We had a band made up of Kriegers, you know, and they, in fact, I got two of the records that they made. One guy wrote a song. We had later on, we had the. I bought the record of the two swords that they used to play. Mm-hmm. We'd have plays. All the crazies would dress up as women, and we'd have little plays, little entertainment. Yeah, we did have that.
Is that the word?
As long as we had the dining room. After that, of course, we lost it because there was nothing there.
By the way, you used the phrase Kriegs. Is that the prisoner of wars?
Yeah, the full name is Kriegsgefangenen in German. So we call ourselves Kriegs. Mm. And that name stuck. We knew who Kriegs were.
Were you able to sort of follow the progression of the war through that information being passed around?
It gave us the information about the... June 6th, you know, we heard
the
about
D-Day,
that.
Yeah,
we used to get reports at once of how they they had some guys very clever bought the parts for the radio and everything, and they would get all that information. We used to get the London, the BBC, and they would give us the scoop, but only one guy had it. I don't even know where the radio was. And they would come searching for stuff.
they get the parts from trading with the guards. Is that?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Generally with cigarettes. We didn't have any money. Oh yeah, incidentally, I had about two or three pounds. Fortunately, when I got shot down, I had just been paid. Pay had finally caught up to me. Several months' pay, and I was smart enough just before I was shot down to send it home. All I kept was about 20 pounds. And the Germans took that. So I didn't have any money. And I didn't have anything in my wallet. I never drove a car. I didn't have any kind of credit cards. They didn't even have credit cards in those days. I had nothing in my wallet except the money. Nothing. A lot of guys had all kinds of personal things and stuff. I never had anything but the money. That small 20 pounds, whatever the hell it was.
What was the relationship with the guards like?
Well, the ones incidentally, we were in this thing 625 paces around. Me and Montgomery Douglas Gibbon used to walk that all the time. Between us and the gate, there was about a 10-foot strip. Over here, I just had one line of barbed wire. But if you crossed over on this side of the wire with the fence here, those old guys up there, all old men, they weren't any of the elite soldiers. The old men, they had a big gun, and they shot. They didn't hit anybody, but they shot at a couple of guys, like they chase a ball without thinking, jumped in, pick up the ball, the guy would shoot at them right away. But the other guards, a lot of them had been in the United States before the war. Some of them could speak English. Like that guy that I told you warned us don't talk too much. So the guards were fairly friendly.
Was there
except the top guy? The top guy that was there, he was a guy a typical. If he wasn't queer, that guy was. He used to wear lipstick and everything. So he was a straight. But he was ahead of everything. He called the shots. He was the top security guy, SS guy, you know, and. So he used to give the orders on what the hell we could do and not do. But there are other, but the common, they were, some guys, a lot of guys used to trade with them. But we weren't supposed to. It's supposed to, you could get better things by, you know. But mostly cigarettes we'd give them. We had no money.
Was there ever any discussion about escape?
Well, that's another thing. Several people tried it, but you had to get permission. You had to go up and get permission from the, you know, your powers that be, and they want to know what kind of a plan, what were you going to try to do, and only one at a time. See, in other words, they didn't want a lot of them. You had to ask permission, and they would give you the time to, and several trunks. What's that thing? I know the word. When you dig a hole in the ground.
A tunnel.
A tunnel, right. Several tunnels were tried, but the Germans would never, They had dogs and everything that would go under the house and smell around, the police dogs, you know. And I think they let us pass the time because nobody ever got out. Because they would wait until you were getting close to the fence or whatever, and then they would cave it in and they'd close it up. They would let you play if you wanted, but that was a terrible thing to have to try. And you had to get permission to stop because they didn't want, you know, if somebody had a good idea, they were hoping. And a couple of guys did get out by hiding in the trucks to bring supplies. Very few of them. But they always ended up back. They put them in solitary when they came back. And then,
were there guys that were really had a lot of ingenuity as far as things they would make?
And, oh, yeah.
I mean, things like what?
Yes. You'd be surprised. Even I had made one. I made myself a dish out of... The only thing we had to play with were Klim cans. Klim cans is reverse milk, Klim. Milk cans, they were like this, a pound of powdered sugar you'd get in them. And those was what we had, those were part of our tools. And the only thing I got out of my 14 months was the knife that I used to use at the dinner table. I still got it. It's even had the, not the swastika, but it had the German eagle on top. Now it's all worn out. I still got it. That's the only thing I brought out. When we left, I brought out plus my Kriege books. They did give us Kriege books to write stuff. I got ones with the meals that I would like. Oh, yeah, I have to tell you about that. We were allowed, every month, they would give us 3 postcards and 4 very flimsy letters, you know, a letter that you'd fold over like this. You'd fill it up. All right, 7. That's all you got. Me, I knew every girl I knew I used to write to. I was like the brother. When I was growing up, I was always like a brother to everybody. They used to tell me about, I was always the brother, never the boyfriend. They used to tell me about their boyfriends. Anyway, so a lot of guys, even the married guys, would write 1. And so I used to gather everyone. I said, you got the extra. I was sending out everyone I could find. And they also say you're not supposed to send more than 7 of them a month. And so I got caught. And they said, if we catch any more of your stuff again, you won't get any. So I slowed down, but I never quit. I used to send, this Murphy, another Kentuckian, this Murphy, he's one of the few guys who was married. He would send one a month. I'd get all his 7. I thought, we had nothing else to do except reading. I used to write letters. I used to not tell him anything about what we were going on. I would just ask him what was going on.
Because they would be censored and that kind of thing.
Because me, even even when I was in service, when I was in a prisoner of war camp, me, I'd go down to, they always have 25 letters that I was getting because I was writing to everybody. Every girl I ever met, I'd write to. And I had really no study. The only girl that I was going with fairly steadily when I was went into service, the one that kept me from getting there on time, she never wrote very much. She didn't write. She said, they told me not to write. They did recommend to families not to write too often because a lot of them I never got. A lot of them that they wrote I never got.
Did the conditions deteriorate over time as the end of the war started to get closer? You know, the food got worse, you know, that kind of thing.
Oh, yes. After the... Well, I got to tell you about this. After we quit getting parcels, now we're at the point where you get 1 meal a day. And it was dehydrated vegetable soup. Now, dehydrated vegetable soup that takes carrots and celery, and you name it, and they would let it dry. They would put it in a big tub and soak it for 24 hours. No salt, no nothing, no taste. And it got so bad, we would get one plate of that a day. And it was like eating sticks. I mean, it had no flavor whatsoever. I don't know if it had any rights good for your body or anything. All I know is that, I'm pretty well endowed in the rear end here. And I got a lot of fat, but boy, I used to sit on those benches. We just had a picnic table with two benches. That's all in our room. And when I'd sit on that bench, boy, my bones were sitting on the bench. But I never knew what, they never weighed me when I got out. But boy, I was only 160 when I went in, so I didn't have much to lose. But that dehydrated vegetable was so bad that I don't like the brown bread. I used to trade my two slices a day for somebody's and give them my soup. In other words, I had four slices of that bread I didn't like a day in place of the soup. But fortunately, that happened towards the end, maybe the last month or so of the war, when it really got rough. For Stalag Luft, May 8th didn't mean a damn thing. The rest of the country was out, but the Russians were holding us. The Russians came in. It was after May 8th that the Russians showed up, because we didn't do it. I told you, we dug that. Did I tell you we dug those slit trenches all over the camp? Because they says the Russians will probably shoot first and ask questions later. So hit the trenches when we see the first tank. And sure enough, they started to talk to the powers that be. And you know what they did? As soon as the Russians took over the camp, they killed some cattle around there, and they gave us a bowl like this of hamburger, a real bowl full of hamburger. We never got to eat it. We got to bury it, because shortly thereafter is when we left. So we never ate hamburger, but the Russians were trying to take care of us, because they wanted to take us to Odessa. I told you about they were going to ship all 8,000 of us to Odessa. And it so happened that an American general came in, flew in, and the war was over and everything, you know, and the Russians wouldn't let us go. And so consequently, they told us, these guys came in airplane, they're leaving in airplane. Standing room only, the Americans, in B-17s, B-24s, anything that would fly. We had to get 8,000 out of there in a hurry before the Russians started to shoot. Because,
where did they fly you to then?
All prison walls ended up at that camp in...
Lucky Strike?
Lucky Strike, yeah. Oh, you know about it. You remember better than me. I remember when you tell me. Camp Lucky Strike. And you know, we had worse accommodations at Lucky Strike than we had in the prisoner of war camp. We were in tents, and it rained. The water was coming. We were in those crazy cots that were worse than my bed in prisoner of war camp. You know, that crazy folding up cot. And the water coming in the those tents. We never lived in tents. And then they only feed us once a day, and you have to stand in line. This Tex Conway used to stand in line three times. The whole camp was getting fed like chicken and stuff. I stood in line once and just got a piece of chicken or whatever. And he used to stand in line. He used to eat and go back, stand in line again.
Well, how did you get home then after that?
Well, we were really stuck there. First of all, they gave us any kind of uniform they could find, because we didn't have, you know, we didn't, ours were kind of bedraggled, you know. We never got any, some guys needed shoes and everything, but I had the low quarter shoes. I didn't even have my shoes, and mine didn't even fall off my feet. Some people, when they bailed out, they lost their shoes. Mine, they didn't disappear. My boots didn't even fall off. The Germans took those.
Did they get you on a victory ship at some point?
Well, for a long time, a lot of guys, as soon as they got some money and the uniform, they went to Paris. But me, I was anxious to get the hell out of there, and I didn't want to leave camp. So we'd stay there and waited, and you know, there were so many trying to get away. A lot of guys disobeyed the law. We weren't supposed to leave camp, but they took off. They went. The ones that went to Paris got taken care of. Every place they went, they loaned them money and do stuff like that. They really treated the prisoners good that went to Paris, but I didn't. I was waiting to get the hell on a boat and get away. So finally what happened was they were allowing some people to go back to their base. And Tex Cottery was with the 100th. Now the 100th is the famous one that used to lose. They used to fly with us, you know, the 100th and the 95th and ours, 390, right? And so he says he had gotten permission to go back to his base. And so I said, I text, I'll go with you. I said, we'll fly out of England after that, maybe we'll, you know. And so I went with him. And guess what? We went to his officers club, and I said, boy, I finally get a good meal. Guess what they had for eating? Liver. A big slab of liver this big. And liver is one meat that I've never eaten in my life. I took one bite once, and it's so bitter I didn't like it. So mind you, here I was starving all this time, and they gave me liver. I took one piece. It wasn't any better than it was when I was not starving. So I asked for a cheese sandwich, and they gave me. That's what I had my first with American a cheese sandwich. I told Tex, I said, gee, they could have had anything else except liver. But we stayed in London for a while, and finally we came back on the new Queen Mary, and all the ex-prisoner of war up on the top deck. We had generals that had worse accommodations than we did.
What was it like getting back to the U.S.?
Oh, that was great. Oh, boy. That was really nice. Because we landed in New York anyway, and which was an opportunity for me to get home. But of course, I was anxious to get the hell out. So the first thing they shipped us to Fort Dix, I guess it was, and that's where they released us and told us we got 60 days leave, and that was it. Then I don't know really. I adjusted when I came back. It didn't take long. I stayed in, you know, for a while. I stayed in until January of 47. I didn't get out right away. After my 60 days, fortunately, I was scheduled to go to navigation school because we were going to Germany.
Japan.
Japan. We were going to Japan. And I was on Times Square on August the 14th. When they finally said the war in Japan is over, August 14th. And you should have seen pandemonium, Times Square, New York. Every girl you passed, they kissed, and everybody was kissing everybody else. We had just happened to be, I didn't know what was going to end then. The real, you know, they signed finally September the 1st or 2nd, whatever it was. But on August the 14th, I'm almost sure it's the right date, that's when the war ended in Japan.
How did you feel at that point?
Oh, boy. I said, boy, I don't have to go to Japan and bomb those people over there and get captured again.